Appreciate you folks being here this morning. Let's take our Bibles, and we're going to, I know last week, we'll be back into our study of John's Gospel, but we're going to go to another portion of John today, and then we'll be here this morning, and I think next week we'll be back into our study of John chapter 5, where we left off, but I feel like the Lord wants us to be here today. John chapter 16. We had a week here at Capital City Baptist, had several folks in the hospital. We've had an emergency situation in our church this week with a family in our church. Not able to share all the details yet. We don't know all the details yet, but Diana Moore's here today. Brittany is here somewhere, but Steve is not. He's in the hospital. Steve had some type of a breakdown Thursday evening and disappeared. He was gone for about a day and a half. Found him Saturday morning down below Columbus. Had been out in the weather during that storm. Just was gone, and he's in the hospital right now getting treatment. It's been a difficult week for the Moores, especially Diana, Brittany, and Steve. And we've had some other folks in the hospital this week. We got news confirmed this week, or I guess the week before. A family in our church, dear family, is their job's moving them away. The Williams family, Jim and Tracy, Kayla and Megan, their job is taking them south of Columbus, and it's just too far away. They'll have to relocate down around the Wilmington, Washington courthouse area. We don't mind if Jimmy leaves. We like the girls and Tracy. We're trying to work out the situation here. So, you get things like that happen. The Lord brings people. He brought the Williams to us at the time we needed them.
Hey.
And they've been a huge blessing here at our church. Mm-hmm. And I'm excited to hear where the Lord's going to lead them next in another church that will need them. And I expect and anticipate they'll get just as involved there as they've been here. And the Lord will bring us someone else to fill their role. Today, Jim and Tracy are there teaching our young people. And so that means the Lord's got something else in mind. And so we just wait on the Lord. But you think about it, in a week's time, today we'll leave here and life begins tomorrow, doesn't it? Mm-hmm. We're back in the grind. We're back in our Monday through Saturday lives, and a lot of things are going to happen this week. Some things we have no idea, no anticipation of what could take place this week. And then we'll come together again next Sunday, Lord willing.
Amen.
And we bring all of those things with us. Mm-hmm. And sometimes it's hard to hear the message then, isn't it? Because you've still got life. I imagine today Diana's heart, our body and mind are here, but her heart's somewhere else, a lot of things. And you know, you try to put those things aside for a moment, but it's life. And I think God does bring things into our lives at times to mold us, develop us, to mature us, to prepare us. Mm-hmm. And so today, you brought life with you here. So let's ask God, what do you want me to learn in life? John chapter 16, verse 33. Just one verse of scripture here today in this passage. I'm going to read it chapter 4. Look at this verse with me. And I want to encourage you, if you have a pen and you can take the habit of underlining words or circling verses, even if you're using a pew Bible today, I'll give you permission to write in this, to underline. If you've got your electronic Bible today, take your magic marker and just mark right on the screen there for us there. And I want you to see these thoughts here this morning. God's Word, John 16, verse 33. These things have I spoken, this is Jesus speaking, these things have I spoken unto you, that in me ye might have peace. In the world ye shall have, say that word with me,
tribulation.
In the world ye shall have tribulation, but be of good cheer. I have overcome the world.
Amen.
In the world ye shall have tribulation. If you haven't figured it out, we're in the world. If you're born again today, you're saved. You know Jesus Christ is your Savior. This is not home, by the way.
Mm-hmm. All right.
This is temporal. We're pilgrims, it says in the book of Hebrews, passing through, but we're in the world today. And in this world, you're going to have tribulations. We have a dear sister here today. It's a huge tribulation. With a brother in the hospital bed there at Grand Hospital, it's a huge tribulation today. Garnell, our dear brother, I got a call last night. He's going to the hospital. His heart's out of rhythm again. He's having a tribulation. We've got Ruth Clifton. Ed Jones was in the hospital here recently. Ed's mom was in the hospital. Ruth's daughter, Susan, going through terrible cancer. We took a prayer request this morning in our Sunday school class. Other folks in tribulations.
Right.
In this world, ye shall have tribulations. It's been said that you're either in a tribulation, just coming out of a tribulation, or just getting ready to go into one. Ain't that good news this morning? Let's go home, huh? That's what we have to look forward to. That's reality, isn't it? In this world, there's tribulation. So I mentioned a few today, but I don't know the ones that are in your hearts today.
Right.
The ones that have been private, the ones that are silent, the ones that haven't made them known. Really, I look out here today and I see a bunch of people that need Jesus Christ.
Amen.
That need God. That need His Word. That need the Lord. You're looking at somebody today that needs this. I'm in a world full of tribulation. I don't like it. I don't like to get those phone calls late at night. I don't like to get this and say, someone's hurting, someone's sick, someone needs this. I don't like that, but that's the world we live in.
Mm-hmm. Right.
It's been said, why do we go through tribulation? Well, first of all, we can go through tribulation to see who we really are.
Amen.
Let me remind you, and let me caution you, many times people, they, when they go through the great trials, the great tribulations, they walk away from God.
Mm-hmm.
And that's the exact opposite thing that should happen.
Right.
But it happens so frequently. How many times have I knocked on someone's door just in a cold call, just going door to door trying to meet people, and I get to talk to someone and they tell me, I used to go to church, and I used to do, well, what happened? And it comes back to they had a real difficulty at a time in their life, and I just got out of church. Man, that's the time we ought to come running closer to God.
Amen.
That's the time we ought to get and say, God, I got to get to know you better. Mm-hmm. You find out who you really are. You find out who your friends are.
Mm-hmm. Amen.
Amen.
And thank God for godly, good friends.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
I don't want to minimize this at all today. The importance of each other in our lives. In fact, that's part of our calling as a church family.
Mm-hmm. Right.
You know, we don't always like what family does. But you're still there for your family, aren't you?
Amen.
You love them, you help them. Doesn't mean that you always support what they do, but you're there to pick them up and help them. And all that's family, and we need to be there. You find out who your friends are. Who you are, who your family are, or who your friends are. And then, thirdly, and most importantly, you can find out who God is. God can take the worst of situations and make good out of them.
Amen.
Right.
That's what makes God God. See, I can just make a bigger mess of things.
Mm-hmm.
But God is able to make good.
Amen.
Romans chapter 8, verse 28, and we know all things work together for what?
Good.
Good. To those who love God, to them who are called according to His purpose. God can make good out of the bad. I see some situations at times and I don't see how it can ever be changed, how it can ever be fixed. I've seen marriages that were just in shambles, but yet God steps in.
Mm-hmm. Right.
Amen.
Intervenes, and God does good. Excuse me, how was I?
You had a hiccup.
Right. I thought I heard some the first time. Yeah, I was convinced it was the second time. Speaking of tribulation, sounds like so this morning, I want us to bring all of our trials together here today. I want to ask the question, God, what do you want me to learn? What do you want me to see? How do you want me to grow in this situation?
All right.
As I was preparing this last week, for some messages and for some broadcasts. And I got the call Thursday evening about Steve, and we certainly spent a lot of time in prayer that evening. And Friday, I was preparing for a radio broadcast, and I just couldn't get my mind off this passage of Scripture, Hebrews chapter 4. Hebrews chapter 4. So my radio broadcast was on Hebrews chapter 4. He put me on a broadcast tomorrow. And so I started trying to get ready for Sunday's message, and I just couldn't get my heart and my mind off Hebrews chapter 4. So here we are this morning in this passage of Scripture, Hebrews chapter 4. The book of Hebrews is written in... The author isn't listed. Many people believe it to be the Apostle Paul, and I would fall into that camp for the most part. I wouldn't be shocked or offended if it turned out to be somebody else, but I feel like it fits in that passage or in his style of writing. And it's written to the Hebrews, if you couldn't figure that out. Just like the book of Romans is written to the Romans, the church at Rome, and the church at Philippi for the book of Philippians, and so on and so forth. This is written to the Hebrew people. And what the book of Hebrews, one of its themes is, it's showing us and teaching us that the author is teaching that Christ is better than what they have. Christ, if you read through this, you'll see that they're saying Christ is better than Moses and the other Old Testament prophets. Christ is better than angels. Christ is better than the law. Christ is better than Melchizedek. Christ is better. Christ is more. Christ fulfills and does more than these other passages or these other individuals. And in chapter number 4, you're going to see here that he's going to say that Christ is better than their Jewish ritual system. He's better than their priest. He's better than their high priest. Now you remember in their system in the Old Testament, they were required to maintain the law, and then each year they were to make a sacrifice. It was Yom Kippur, the Jewish title of this great feast and day, and we know it as the Day of Atonement. And on that day, the high priest, the main priest, the head priest, would go and they'd make a sacrifice, and then they would take that once a year into the Holy of Holies, the holiest place in there in the tabernacle, the temple, and they would go and they'd make atonement for the sins of the people. And guess what? They'd have to do it again the next year, and the next year, and the next year. Well, it says here in Hebrews chapter 4, look at verse 14, seeing then that we have a great high priest that is passed into the heavens, just like the priest would pass beyond that veil and go to the Holy of Holies, we have a great high priest that has passed into the heavens after his death, burial, and resurrection. In Acts chapter 1, 40 days later, Jesus ascended into heaven. I love that passage of Scripture in Acts chapter number 1. And as the men of Galilee stand there gazing up into the skies, an angel appears before them. And he says, "Ye men of Galilee, why stand ye here gazing? This same Jesus shall so come in like manner." We would like to add to that today, even so, come quickly, Lord Jesus.
Amen.
Come quickly, Lord Jesus. He's coming back someday. The Lord Jesus Christ will return just as he ascended, just as he left. This same Jesus, he says here, he has passed into the heavens. Jesus, the Son of God, let us hold fast our confessions. Jesus Christ is our great high priest. In fact, he is better than their priestly system. He is the great high priest. Verse 15, "For we have not an high priest which cannot be touched with the feelings of our infirmities." In other words, here's what that means. We just wanted to translate that, paraphrase that for you, just to completely understand it. He understands and knows what you're going through. He knows exactly what you're going through today. He knows the great trials and tribulations, and he understands. I got to be honest, I don't know what to say to Diana during a time like this. I can say, "I'm sorry, I love you, I'm praying for you, I will help you," but I don't understand. he understands.
Amen.
Right.
There are times that I've gone through things and people have come in there and I appreciate them and I'm glad they're there with them, but they just don't know how to handle or what to say in a situation. Not so with our great high priest. He does understand. Mm-hmm. He does know. He knows exactly what you're going through, and he understands the infirmities that we go through, because it says this, but was at all points. In all points tempted. That word tempted, we might think of someone as holding something out there to tempt somebody or in that fashion, but it also means the idea of trials. Tried. Mm-hmm. Was at all points tempted or tried like as we are. He's gone through these things. As a human being, he suffered physically, he suffered emotionally, he suffered in these ways that we go through today. He had hard days, he had hard weeks, he got blisters on his feet just like you and I do, he got splinters in his hand just like you and I do, and he went through emotional difficulties. What's the rest of that verse say? Yet without sin. Was tempted in all points like as we are, yet without sin. It means this, he handled it right.
Mm-hmm.
He went through those things and handled it right. Can that be said of me? No. I've gone through difficulties, but not always handled them correctly.
Right.
I've responded and reacted, and I've done things in the wrong way, and so have you.
That's right.
But not our great high priest. Not the Lord Jesus Christ. He was tempted or tried in all points just like we are. He understands what we're going through. He knows our infirmities. And he's gone through them without sin. So now the author does this. He says this, let us therefore come boldly unto the throne of grace. Certainly the word boldly, it describes a confidence. It certainly does not describe an arrogance. Don't ever go demanding to God.
Right.
That's not what the author, that's not what the writer of Hebrews is telling us to do. Really, if you get down to the definition and you look at the Greek word, here's what it means. It means to come plainly. See, let me just be honest. If I was going through a great trial and Dave came to try to aid me, he said, Pastor, what's going on? What's happening? And I'm going to talk to him. I'm going to have a tendency to want to sugarcoat what's going on in my life. Because I'm embarrassed, I'm frustrated, I'm aggravated, and I maybe not want him to know everything that's going on, all the details. And so I have the tendency, well, Dave, I appreciate that, and here's what's going on, but I don't share everything, or I smooth it over, or I make it seem, you understand what I'm saying? Mm-hmm. The word boldly means this, just come and don't sugarcoat it at all. Just come plainly to talk to God, to talk to the Lord Jesus Christ. It means this. He already knows. He already understands. He already knows your circumstances, your situations. And so I don't have to come to him and try to smooth it over, try to be all sweet and sugarcoat this. I can just come say, God, here's my situation, here's my problem, and I want to give it to you today. Come boldly under the throne of grace. Now, we studied this not too long ago on our Wednesday nights. The throne of grace. Think about that. The throne of grace. Where is the throne of... First of all, what is a throne for? It's for a king, isn't it? It's the throne. It's a place for monarchy. It's a place for a king or a queen. It's a place of position. Come to the throne of grace. That throne of grace, guess where it is today? It's where Jesus Christ sits. Where is Jesus Christ today?
Mm-hmm.
He's in heaven. God is inviting the author says to go into the very presence of the Lord, to go into the very throne room of God, into his presence. You are being ushered into heaven when you pray,
right,
when you talk to the Lord, into his very throne room of grace. Oh my, what an amazing thought this is. By the way, the only way it's possible is because our great high priest ascended into the heavens. And he paid the price. It's through his shed blood. It's because of the blood of Jesus Christ that you and I can be in his very presence today.
Amen.
What an amazing cost that was to give you and I the access and the rights as God's children to come into His presence. By the way, when was the last time you were there? Yeah. By the way, when was the last time you've been in the presence of God in prayer? Even though it cost Jesus Christ His life, it cost Him a great price, God gave His Son, and yet we don't pray. We refuse to talk to God. He's given us access, and we refuse to do it. I'm too busy. Life's going on. I'm busy today. I just don't want to. What it comes down to is this. We don't want to take care of it. We know there's things that need to be taken care of before we can get into His presence. Let me encourage you today to not become lazy spiritually and not to become indifferent spiritually and to get that taken care of and take advantage of the great privilege the Lord has given us to come into His presence, into the throne room of grace. Come boldly into the throne of grace, it says here. And continues on, that we may obtain mercy. See, we must come first of all to the throne of grace. And then we obtain mercy. This mercy is from the Lord. He bestows it upon us. We don't deserve it. We certainly haven't earned it. But we come and we beg for mercy. We come and we cry out for mercy. But notice what it says there. We come to the throne room of grace that we may obtain mercy. And then what? We find grace. What is grace? You know another word that would be used, and it's goodness. We come for mercy, and God gives us goodness.
Man.
I come and I'm begging, Lord, just get me out of this, help me, and we beg for the mercy of God, which we ought to. Then the goodness of God takes over, and He begins to bless us and give us good things. He blesses us, and we find this grace here in verse number 16. But notice that last phrase there, to help in time of need. Get your pen out again and underline that. To help in time of need. When are you in a time of need? The sooner we realize this, the sooner we get this, the better off we are. You know when you're in a time of need? Always. You need Him every day.
Amen.
Now, there's some days that are worse than other days.
Amen.
We've experienced that this week. We have loved ones that have gone through that. But you can count on it. Your days are coming.
Amen.
All right.
It might be a phone call from that doctor after that doctor's appointment. I need to see you right away. Mm-hmm. It might be from that boss that says, I need to talk to you.
Mm-hmm.
It might be... got to move. It might be all any of these things. Health, financial. You might hear from a spouse. They don't love you anymore.
Mm-hmm.
Wait, listen. Your days are coming.
Right.
And you need Jesus to help in a time of need. You realize He's just a prayer away. He's right there. He's on guard. He's waiting. He's looked. And He already knows. He's just waiting for you to come to the throne room of grace. So this week, I don't know what the future holds. I'm praying for a nice, easy week.
Amen.
What if somebody called me this week and said, Pastor, I just got huge raise. I got a promotion. I'm taking you to Hawaii with me. Santa Montecalmi this week. Give me some good news. But reality is we live in this world. In this world, ye shall have tribulation.
All right.
As God's children, we have access. We have a pathway to God today.
Mm-hmm.
Let us take advantage of it. Let us come boldly to the throne of grace. That we may obtain mercy and find grace to help in a time of need. Your time of need may be today, this week, this month, this year.
Mm-hmm.
Reality is we just started a new year. Reality is probably not everybody that's here today will be here this time next year. Mm-hmm. Life will have ended. Life will have moved on. Life will have taken its reality. There'll be someone new here. But life continues on. And we need the Lord Jesus Christ as we continue to go through this life each and every day.
Right.
We encourage you. Let's go to the throne of grace. Would you bow your heads and close your eyes with me today?